My name is Safia Mohammed Adamu. I come from Nigeria. Nigeria is located on the west coast of Africa. It's Africa's most populous nation with about 173 million people. It's Africa's largest economy. It's Africa's largest exporter and producer of crude oil. Interestingly, Nigeria is a monoproduct economy. How it got there? From agriculture, but it's a monoproduct economy. It's an economy tied strongly to oil, and it so happened that every economic expenditure is tied to revenue from oil. For example, the national budget is pegged on the prices of oil at the international market, which essentially means that if prices at the international market sneeze, no, we don't catch cold. What happens is we just simply spiral towards economic precipice, and by some chance we actually halt and try to look back, which we never quite do, until the oil prices pick up again. In the last 5 years, Nigeria made about $470 billion from oil. In the same year, in the same period, Nigeria was ranked. In the same period, Nigeria was ranked to have the highest number of infant and maternal mortality in the sub-region. In the same period, Nigeria ranked 136th out of the 174 countries about that studied by the Transparency International. In the same period, Nigeria was 152 in the same under the Human Development Index. Nigeria spends or budgets 8.5% for education. The UNICEF recommends 26% of total budget for all developing countries. Nigeria per capita income is 23,400. Equatorial Guinea has 548,000. Kuwait has 3.8, all oil producing countries. Nigeria is seen as one of the oil rich and one of the richest countries along the sub region. It has 28 million students in its population, out of which 10 million school-aged children are out of school. The per capita energy consumption is 106%. According to international financial institutions, Nigeria is a growing economy. In fact, they hold out much hope for the country at a growth of 7.5%. With that growth, Nigeria actually has a double-digit inflation. Nigeria's unemployment is 23%. Nigeria's unemployment is 23%, and Nigeria's life expectancy is 52 years at birth. The GDP is barely 500 million. And that growth, actually, 7.5% of that growth translates to mean that half of the population live in poverty, and 7% of the poorest population in the country, in the world, actually live in Nigeria. We are very rich. With our economic look and reality, it looks like it's only apparent that we beam the searchlight on the sector. It's against this background that this project was conceived, conceptualized, and actually operationalized. That we may know exactly what happens in the sector. Not that we think the sector is going to play much prominent role in the future given the prices of oil, but given the fact that we need to tackle the crisis here in order to be able to tackle the other sectors. Corruption, naturally, is a phenomenon experienced by every country. No country is exempted. It's the level of corruption that becomes a problem. And in the case of Nigeria, it's particularly debilitating for an economy that relies on one single sector and the massive corruption that goes on. The country produces 2.4 million barrels of oil per day, and you know what? About 150 is lost every day. At the peak of the oil prices, it means Nigeria was losing close to 100 million every day. That's awesome for a country with high mortality rate, high infant death. Nigeria is the one country where recurring expenditure takes a whopping 34% of its income. And it happens from the federal down to the local government levels. This is what Nigeria loses every year in sales, in revenue from oil. And it gets higher. By 2014, actually, it had gone to unpalatable, unacceptable levels. In conceptualizing the issues at stake, this project came to the conclusion of a problem: corruption in the oil and gas sector. And in examining the problem, actually, we realize it's beyond just corruption. Why is corruption sustained? Why is it there? Why is it being institutionalized? Why is it that nobody's in? Then we realize there was a lack of vigilance on the sake of all, on the part of all stakeholders. That kind of determined how the project was going to go. Why is there lack of vigilance? And the lack of vigilance happened to play two ways. One, there's an ineffective regulatory mechanism, an ineffective law to govern the sector. And the lack of regulatory and enforcement mechanisms actually brought about the total lack of transparency, because the existing laws could be played around with. They're weak. There's no other law to enforce them. It's not a bill, and they are actually located in different documents scattered all over the place. If you are one of the contractors or you're applying to be a player in that sector, you are really not sure which of the documents will be pulled up by whoever is in charge at that particular time. And since there's no transparency, nobody's asking for accountability, you find that people don't even ask questions. And that became a bigger problem. If you don't ask questions, nobody's going to be accountable to you. And because of that, we decided to build in the lack of forum for questions into the project. So the entire project actually is trying to beam a searchlight, not just on the oil and gas sector. It's actually trying to prompt the policymakers, government agencies, whoever is responsible, to actually take a very serious look at this sector. And we're hoping that by doing this, they will make readily available, they will look at the regulatory mechanism and decide on what to do with it. Incidentally, there's a bill, the Petroleum Industry Bill, a very ambitious bill that was actually prepared to review, dismantle, rebuild, and whatever of the entire sector. That bill has been there for like 14 years in the parliament. By the time we started this project like last year, there was a lot of pressure in the papers, in the news, for the government to take a look. Because we emphasize on the fact that one of the effects we are having from this problem is the fact that the government is having a serious shortfall in its revenue. It cannot meet development programs. It's not even attempting to take any development programs. Investment in education and health sectors are pretty low. So we went on the planning activities. We went into research. We tried to look at existing data, not just that of Nigeria, but data across board, in search of what could be a best practice. When we have done that, we went into stakeholder meeting, a process by we try to get those who are interested, those who have vested interest, those whose participation and approval will kind of build our strength in trying to make this work, in trying to get this in. In the When we have done that, we then now went ahead to identify collaborators, willing participants, I mean a willing physical participants, not those who will give us tacit approval on what we're going to do. And part of those, the most important aspect of those collaborators were actually the media. And what made it easier for this particular project is that I was driving the media sector, and when you're chairman of the editorial board of a national newspaper, doors open. They don't like it, but it opens. They just open them. So we got that going. One of the first things we did was to prepare a pre-workshop. We organized a pre-workshop to sensitize every participant on our theme. Where are we going? Our goal? What is the objective? Where do we head to? And the issue of the PIB, petroleum industry bills, kept coming up. So we kept hammering on it. We had like four round tables, and two were focused on the PIB because we really wanted the parliament to pick it up. It got to a point that the leadership of the 7th Assembly, the parliament then, at two different press conferences, agreed they were going to ensure the bill got passed. Sometimes the discussions really get heated and interests are thrown at each other. In the long run, we were really looking for reform in the sector. And in the process, we got the bill to pass the third reading stage, awaiting approval. It may not get there, it may get there, but at least we believe it's not really us, but just that our effort kind of woke some people up to their responsibility, and they decided to take it over. And then again, we're able to provide a forum, which is still going on now. While I was here, they still had the radio program and another round table. Still working on this issue. We are not relenting. We don't want to let go. It's not yet Uhuru. And because of these forums, a lot of people, the unexpected, the expected, have been able to speak out. We've had people blowing the whistle. It has cost some people their jobs, like the former Trabang governor lost his job when he kept insisting 20 billion was missing, and a week later he said, oh, there's 45 billion missing. We don't even know where these monies are going to. But the guy kept talking, and many others kept talking. The challenge. Our biggest challenge is actually one single challenge. What next? Right now we have a bill pending. Will it get passed? The process will start all over. But then beyond passing the bill, will there be an enforcement mechanism? Because if the bill goes through, this project still has a lot of work to do. We'll start again on ensuring we have an enforcement mechanism coming in place. What I learned from this project is I'm not a particularly patient person, but I learned patience because partners, would-be collaborators, would-be participants are just not on the same timeline with you. You can't get them to do what you want them to do. But because you want to really get there, you just have to be patient. You hit a bit, you knock a bit, you coerce, you beg, you whatever. After so many phone calls and trips, you finally get something out of them. And then, of course, this directly bears on the discipline. You learn to be disciplined. You learn to be focused, because now you have to document what you're doing, and you realize this documentation is very important, and you keep looking back, hey, this is the project I'm doing. And this design, this whatever it is that I'm doing, you know what? It's going to be replicable somewhere else, because this research is not going to stop here. This advocacy is not going to stop with this sector. This advocacy is just going to go on and on and on. And in the end, when I came in here yesterday after I sent this into Sanjeev, it was like, yeah, I did it. And here I am. Thank you.